Here, record and just mention that we just called in, we just had our invocation to call in the spirits of the seven directions. And now let's just do a check-in and see how everyone is doing. Jima, we missed you last week. How did move-in day go?
Good. I sliced my finger, my foot, but it's all good. It's all good. They're really happy. Yesterday, we really enjoyed the garden for the first time. And my good friend who really lives close now, she gave me this beautiful sun catcher from crystals that she made while her baby napped. And she has a beautiful rainbow baby. She's from Mexico. She came here to Houston because her two-year-old got sick with cancer. And he eventually died, unfortunately. She got pregnant in the lapse of mourning of him. And she has this beautiful girl, which she always, always, always wanted a girl. And they're still here. And we are so fortunate to have her. And she brought this beautiful crystal. She's doing beautiful work. I have to show you and take pictures. This morning, I was trying to catch the sun with it. I'm happy. I feel more settled. Focused. Looking forward to go to Puerto Rico in a couple of weeks. I feel like I just got here. I don't want to go, but I'm going to meet my nephew for the first time, so I'm excited about that. And we're going to baptize them and then come back. The girl, everything's good. Everything's good.
Good. I'm really happy to hear that. And congratulations on your new home.
Thank you. Thank
You're
you.
Welcome. And Jerry, my dear, how are you today and what's new in your world?
Well, I'm good this morning, and I've just been really busy. There's a lot of forward moving energy around my business and just planning out a lot of things. And last night, I'm excited. I found out and booked a booth in August at the Celtic Fantasy Fair here in Portland. And I think that's going to be really fun and right up my alley. So just really focused on work and business.
That's great. And anything moving with your virtual camp or spirit empowerment classes? No, not.
I'm pretty much deciding that that's not going to happen and move on and focus on maybe some smaller classes and, you know, just getting the word out and preparing.
Mm-hmm. Good.
So it feels fine. You know, I was really rushing this and felt hopeful, but it's not exactly the right time, but I know it's coming.
Yep. And I just want to let you know that the same thing is happening for everyone who's been teaching online. The classes are just really coming to a screech right now because people can be outside now. It's safer. So being on Zoom is like, you know, not something people are really looking forward to doing this summer. So classes are coming to a screech everywhere for all teachers that I know of who are teaching online. I'm not surprised.
Definitely. I've been scheduling a few in-person things with the other part of my business and some children's classes in person, maybe in my home.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, that makes sense.
Yeah.
All right. Well, thank you. Raven, how are you doing this week?
Hello, everyone. I'm doing good. I'm just working through some big stuff and making big openings, and it's not easy just, you know, in the muck of it, but walking it clearly, everything's just, you know, everything's out, and that feels really good. I'm happy to walk through the muck with all the truth out. I'm happy to do that. So I'm good. Thank you. Glad to be here.
Yeah, it's nice to have you here. And Yeah, I know what you mean when you're walking through the muck and just acknowledging that, you know, the light on the other side is so worth the trudging through the muck, isn't it? So keep it up is. The good yeah. work.
Yeah, mostly just having the truth out in the muck, mm-hmm. you know?
Yeah, that's great. Yeah, good job honoring your truth. No mud, no lotus. Yes, Jima, absolutely. Corinne, how are you this morning, my dear?
I'm good. I'm just kind of finishing up my office, my new space, because I open up next week. So I'll be fully done with my business in New Hampshire. We'll be in Vermont. Doing good. Kind of hoping to get some sleep. I'm certified in sound healing, but I've been doing a much deeper dive in that. So I'm finishing up my more in-depth training here in a few days. So I'm really excited about that. And I just gotta remind myself, I think, just to slow down. I've been very good with that, but lately I have kind of fallen back into that. So just really honoring and listening to what my body's saying. So
good for you on that. And is that your new office that you're in right now?
Yeah.
Oh, what beautiful color. Yeah. Oh my gosh, that is absolutely wonderful there. That's such a beautiful space.
Thank you.
Well, congratulations on that. I'm really happy that it's all moving forward and everything is coming into place for you. Beautiful.
Thank you.
Yes. And I saw Rochelle just a second ago. Oh, there you are. My screen keeps bouncing around. Hi, Rochelle.
Hey, good morning. How's everybody today?
Good. How are you doing today?
Good. I'm nursing quite the headache and apparently my internet is misbehaving. That's because the sun came out. It was working fine earlier. I don't know. Sorry. Whatever. I'm good. Crazy busy weeks for me. Unwinding with the school year as a bus driver tends to put you at 40 plus hours in a big square box. So it's been, you know, crazy busy, but I managed to catch up on all my homework with you. So that's a bonus. That was a struggle, but I was sitting like I'm on call. So I sit on the side of the road and I get stuff done. I have a bag I carry with me so I could just work on stuff. But I'm good. Next week will be even crazier because it's the last week for me. So, and my cousin that lives in Costa Rica that I told you about, her only child is having a baby. So she's up here. So we're not doing Costa Rica this year because we're here for babies. But we've talked, so we're trying to get together and yeah, it's good. It's good. Looking forward to wherever this leads me. And there's, you know, that's where I'm at. Nice to see everybody.
Wonderful. Thank you for being here. And hang on, I'm opening up a page on my website. I know that we have Victoria left, but I want to remember to open up this particular page for you. Okay, I just did. I'll remember to go to it now. Where did Victoria go? Hang on, there you are. Hi, Victoria.
Hello, I'm doing good. Had a little craziness with headaches and my eyes off the last week, but that kind of passed with the solar eclipse, so I'm kind of happy with that.
Good, I'm glad. Yeah, for those people who are really sensitive to energy, this has been a really intense time. I know it has been for me, and I think I can, I am assuming that just based on some shares and stuff, that there's been some really stuff, heavy stuff going on for some of the rest of you as well. So kudos to everyone for getting through the solar eclipse, new moon, and just being here in and ready to jump into this last class today. I do have some stuff I want to share with you that has come up around Spirit Camp in the past week with one of the other Spirit Camp teachers. And it led me to think about a conversation that I should probably have with you because it's come up twice now. So when the first year I did Spirit Camp, I was using the four poles in the four directions, just like I am now. But what I was using was the four colors that the Lakota people use to designate the four cardinal directions. And because I have been, I was mentored by a Lakota Sundance chief. And anyway, so I was really familiar with Lakota teachings. And I am, I don't know if you guys know what a Sundancer is, but the Sundance is their high religious ceremony for the year. It's a 10-day ceremony, but 4 days of it, people who are Sundancers actually dance in the center of this arbor. It's super, super sacred work. And you go for 4 days and four nights with no food or water. And you, you find that altered state of connection to spirit. Anyway, it's a beautiful, beautiful ceremony. And I am a Sundancer. I've danced in three of them. And so anyway, I felt very comfortable using those Lakota colors on the four poles because of my connection to Chief Redfeather. But somebody sent me an email after that first spirit camp and was really offended by the fact that I, as a white person, was using those colors. So, you know, I went to my shamanic teacher in Maine, I mean, who is also white, and I have other shamanic teachers too. So I kind of reached out to all of them, and I reached out to the Lakota chief that I had been working with for a few years and shared what was going on. And I have to tell you, the Lakota chief, his first words were, "Is that a white person that's complaining?" And I said, "Yes." And he said, "Look, Native Americans don't own love. You're teaching love. You don't need my permission to teach love. We don't own that. So whoever this white person is, tell them we don't own love." So anyway, he was just really kind of adamant in presenting that to me, that like, I don't need anyone's permission. But of course he was supporting, I mean, he supports me in the work that I'm doing with children. So that was a few years ago, but what I decided to do to alleviate me having to defend my position and the fact that I have permission is to change the four banners from the Lakota colors change the four banners. So instead of using the four Lakota colors, I chose to bring in the elements of the four directions, which of course pagans, Wiccans, you know, people all over the world who celebrate earth religions use the elements and the four directions together. So I felt like I was kind of moving one step away from having to defend the teachings. So in this past week, another spirit camp teacher has come up against those complaints or criticisms, and that is what I want to share with you. She had a spirit camp scheduled for Southern Maine, and she was working with the woman who is a yoga teacher. They have a beautiful piece of land, and after Linda started sharing the event online, apparently her husband looked at spirit camp and just called Linda and told her that she wasn't going to be allowed to teach that on the land because it was cultural appropriation. And he was really offended that she was going to be bringing that to his land when she's not Native American. So of course she called me really upset. And my first question to her was, "Is this a white person that's complaining?" So, she said yes. And then I told her what my experience with Chief Redfeather had been, and that, you know, his big teaching out of that for me is that Native Americans don't own love, and that's really what we're teaching children. So there was no way to even have a conversation with this woman's husband. He didn't even want to hear anything. He had made up his mind. It was closed. It was done. So she had to find a new space for her spirit camp. And fortunately, because I've done spirit camps in Southern Maine, I knew of a location that I had done a spirit camp in that is not far from where she was going to be. So like within 48 hours, she had a new home and was ready to go. But I feel like it's important to bring this up in conversation because there are people who I 100% believe that they feel like they are doing the right thing. But without asking any questions, like the woman who complained to me didn't ask any questions, didn't ask if I had, you know, any permissions, didn't ask like what my background is, like didn't ask any questions, just said, this is wrong. So I encourage you to reach out to me if that ever happens to you, because it is not something that I'm unfamiliar with. Although in 6 years, it's only happened twice, once in the first year and once this year. But just know that you may end up coming across someone who is meaning well, but they just don't have enough information to understand that this is something that is pure and coming from the heart. And there are shamanic practices exist in cultures all over the world. That is not something that is Native American owned. And so anyway, I feel like there's nothing in spirit camp that Native Americans have ownership of, if that makes sense to you. And that so much of the work that we're doing is earth-based religion. And that is just, that's global. Every country in the world has people who are practicing earth-based religions. And I feel like this is really supporting those teachings and practices. So that was important for me to share. Does anybody have any questions about that before I move on? Rochelle?
Yeah, I was just confused. The banners that you have currently that you've been doing with us, or you've shown or I've seen, are like clouds and fire. Were they color specific before that? Or
yes.
Because I didn't see them.
Yes.
Yes.
In the very first year, I used colors that can be attributed to Native Americans, you know, for the different directions. Yes. So I just had a plain colored banner on each pole. And then after I got some pushback that year, I decided that it would be easier, instead of defending my position, it would just be easier to switch out to the elements, because that is something that cannot be attributed just to the Native American culture. That's a global thing. So I ended up switching to the elements after the first year. Any other questions about that? No? Okay. All right. So the next thing I want to talk about is, does anybody here live in Massachusetts? Rochelle. Okay. So I'm getting feedback from one of my teachers in Massachusetts that she's having a hard time booking a spirit camp location because Massachusetts is requiring her to jump through a lot of hoops and register as a summer camp. And they want her to have a nurse on staff and have the facility inspected and have the water inspected. There's like so many hoops that the state of Massachusetts is requiring her to jump through if it's a 5-day camp. So I think her way to work around this is like doing a 3-day, a Monday, Wednesday, Friday, 1 week, and the next week, a Tuesday, Thursday, or she's somehow trying to figure out how to work around the really strict rules Massachusetts has, because nobody else has come up with any requirements from states, because this is a really small camp. It's like people are doing like a 1-week camp. So in the state of Maine, we're able to fly under the radar really easily. I don't know if the rules are more lax here or what, but because we're not in the same location for the whole summer, we are just considered like a pop-up camp. And we don't even have to, there's no requirements to belong to the Maine State Summer Camp Association or anything like that. So I just wanted to put out to those of you who are living in states where I don't have any spirit camp teachers yet, to please make sure you check in with your summer camp associations and make sure that you are familiarizing yourself with their rules. And like I did that with the state of Maine, I don't know, after like 3 or 4 years into this, And it was really clear that I don't really qualify as somebody who needs to register for this, because the Spirit Camp is like it's just a pop-up camp. So anyway, I wanted to put that out to those of you who are in states that I have not connected with before.
Ava,
yeah.
You can feel free to share my email with her.
Okay.
If she needs some assistance, or maybe we can collaborate and try to find some loopholes on my end and her end together.
Okay.
Awesome. More than willing to join leagues with her.
Okay. Thank you. All right. So then third thing is, I want to do a screen share here. Poor Rochelle was really keeping me in the loop with what was happening with the affiliate link I gave you this week. So in the affiliate link, I'm coming into ThriveCart here. I just want to show you, Rochelle, that I fixed what you were talking about. But all right, let me go to the affiliate section here. That's it right here. Nope. Oh my gosh, hang on one second. Create new affiliate. I might have to find this during lunch. Because there's a yep, I'll find it during lunch because I don't want to take up time here. But anyway, in the page that you found, Rochelle, I finally, the one that said $100, there was still old pricing information in there. And then as it turns out, it was really complicated. It is a complicated program and I couldn't figure it out so much last time. So I just, when I interview people, I just say, how did you hear about Spirit Camp? And if it's from another Spirit Camp teacher, boom, they get the affiliate money. But I'm trying, as the company grows, I'm trying to make it all automated. And so, and I updated the amount from $100 to $200, and I hadn't changed that in the page where Rochelle had been signing up as an affiliate, but that has been corrected now. So I just wanted to let you guys know that if you do want to be an affiliate, I will be sending out an email with information soon that has like sample emails that you could send to your friends and some sample graphics that you could use. And, there was something else I was going to say there and it just popped out of my head. I don't know what it was, but I am still trying to find people for the in-person training in August. So that's the one that I'm really focusing on right now. And Rochelle, did you have a question about that?
So when I click on your link, I'm going to try to show this to you. This is what pops up. Can you see that on your end?
Yep. Yep,
and I changed. The numbers changed, but the information down here, it wants my affiliate ID and stuff. I don't have one. Let me just go back one spot. This is the options that we get when we click on the link.
Okay, and did you click on I don't have a ThriveCart account?
It doesn't let me, and then it says the only option is the sign up and register.
Yeah, but that's registering as an affiliate, not register for ThriveCart.
Yeah, and that's the one I click on, and then it asks my name, my email address, the affiliate ID, and a business company. That's what happens.
Okay, so
I'm still having technical issues with that.
Okay, so let's work on that. Well, I have availability tomorrow if you want. Gosh, I would love to have you just work with me and troubleshoot this, because you're gonna like unlock the key to all of my affiliates in the future. So if we can like set up a little Zoom call at some point in time, I would love that, because then it'll be easier for everyone. Are you good with that?
Yeah, it'll be sometime tomorrow afternoon. I'll send you an email tomorrow.
Okay, perfect.
All right.
All right. Thank you for that. Okay. And then I think that is it for now. I have the word coaches written down to talk about, and I have no idea what I meant by that. So let me know if that means anything to any of you guys. Don't know what it means. Okay. And Jerry, I just want you to know I have the measurements down on my to-do list for tomorrow. So I will get those to you by the end of the day tomorrow. Okay. That is it. So I'm going to screen share and we'll go into the SEL curriculum.
Hey, what happened to Lindsay? Is she okay?
I have not heard anything from Lindsay. So, yep, can't, I don't know. So when you open the SEL and Virtual Spirit Camp curriculum, you'll see Virtual Spirit Camp is here. And this is the SEL stuff here. And we're going to do the SEL stuff this morning. And let's see. This is what I did at the beginning of the pandemic when I created all of that free stuff for kids. So let's start up at the top here. All right, the very first class that I did in the pandemic was, excuse me, a story about emotions. And this is the Color Monster. This was the perfect class to start with. I'm gonna stop screen share for a minute because the world had just shut down. Kids were out of school. They were in lockdown with everybody else. And it was a really confusing time for everyone. And this book was so helpful for so many of the parents who were in the class with that kid, with their kids that day. It's a really short book. I'm gonna read it quickly for you. And this is a perfect book, I think, if you've got something big and heavy going on and you know you've got a group of kids who are all impacted by it, especially if they're young. But I have kids as old as 12 in this class and they were all participating. This is the Color Monster. Today he woke up feeling confused and he doesn't know why. Are you all mixed up again, Color Monster? Your emotions don't work well when they're all jumbled up. You should try to separate them and put each one in its own jar. If you like, I can help you. Let's try to make sense of how you're feeling. This is happiness. It shines yellow like the sun and twinkles like the stars. When you're happy, you laugh and jump and dance and play. You want to share your happiness with everyone. This is sadness. It is lonely and blue like a rainy day. It washes over you like the sea. When you're sad, you hide and want to be alone. You don't want to do anything except maybe cry. It's okay to cry, Color Monster. This is anger. It burns red like a fire and it's hard to stamp out. When you're angry, life can feel unfair. Sometimes you want to take your anger out on others, but I'll be nice to you, Color Monster, and your anger will disappear. This is fear. It hides and runs away like a mouse in the night. When you're afraid, you feel tiny. You think you don't have the courage to face the gray shadows, but I can help you find your way. This is calm. It is quiet like the trees and as light as green leaves swaying in the wind. When you're calm, you breathe slowly and deeply, and you feel at peace. Now you can rest, Color Monster. all of your feelings are in the right place. See, don't you feel much better? Uh-oh, I see you're feeling something new. You look different, Color Monster. Tell me, how do you feel now? Then I ask the kids, how do you think the Color Monster feels now? Because there's no other text. The end. So at the end of this book, I asked the children to just share with me what color their color monster is today. And we went through each child in the Zoom room, and there were a lot that first day. And then I asked the children as we were going through, because children were really having fun identifying their color monster color. I asked children to take a paper and pencil or crayons or something and start drawing a picture of what their color monster looks like. And I got so many emails after that class from parents who said, thank you. We didn't know how to check in with our kids, or our kids don't have the vocabulary to be able to tell us how they're feeling. But just by using the color monster, we were able to get a grasp on what our kid is experiencing at the beginning of this shutdown. Because this was the very first day schools were closed in March of 2020. So we spent the entire class with the kids talking about their color monster. And like, I remember one child's color monster was black, which represented fear. And he said, yeah, my color monster is black, and this is what it looks like. And I said, well, would your color monster like to share any information about why he's feeling black? So the kid was able to talk a little bit more about that. And I could see the mom on the couch, like her eyes were like big and like really taking in hearing her child talk to me when she hadn't been able to get that information out of her child all day. So anyway, I encourage you guys to use this book, even if you've got kids or grandkids that are really struggling and having a hard time, especially if they're on the younger side and don't have words to put to how they're feeling yet. That is one that can really give you a lot of information, just having them connect it to the color monster. So after the next day, I wanted to provide tools for the children to start developing a toolbox of positive behavior and practices that they could do at home. And because I had so many parents on the call with me, I can screen share the document again. I was able to talk to the parents a little bit while the children were coloring their pages for me. So the next one I did was a gratitude practice. And while the kids were coloring, you know, I may have used this statement here and talked to the parents a little bit about why a gratitude practice is so important to maintain, you know, like positive attitude and positive mental health. So I read this book called Grow Grateful. And it's a great book that describes what gratitude is. And afterwards, after reading this book, I'm going to read like every other book, because there's like 12 books here. We can't read them all. And this one's on the longer side. I'll read the short ones, like Color Monster short. But this one is about a kid learning going camping. And there's more text in this one, and it's longer. But she ends up learning about gratitude on this camping trip. So after I read this particular book, I would ask the children to go around one at a time and tell me something that they're grateful for, which the kids were really, it was really easy for them to do. But then I realized that with some older kids, it was, I wanted to give them something more. So I had the kids coloring this coloring page that I have down here, my gratitude garden. This is something that I use as like in public schools when I do any teaching in public school classrooms. Write something you're grateful for in each flower and watch your gratitude garden bloom. Did I show you this coloring page before, you guys? I can't remember. Okay, I use this one a lot. And it's good for preschoolers all the way up through like second grade. And the kids, with teachers, I tell them that you could do one flower a day, Monday through Friday. And at the end of the week, the kids have created their gratitude garden and they can take it home with them. Or if you're doing it as an exercise, like I did in that one virtual class, or if you're, even if you're in person, this could be part of like a 45-minute gratitude module. And the kids could create their gratitude garden all in at the same time. But even there, I decided that I wanted to have something for the older kids. So I'm trying to scroll up here. It's kind of locking up a little bit. So hang on. Oh, there we go. Okay. So I talked to the older kids about when we get off the call, maybe it would be a nice practice for you, as we're dealing with so much unknown right now, to create a gratitude journal. And you can start your day or end your day every day with a gratitude journal. And we talked about how they could decorate it, or how they, what materials they might want to use to create it. I also talked about creating a gratitude collage. I mean, it's like a vision board, but with things that you're grateful for, and just put it up on the bedroom wall. We had I just showed you the gratitude garden coloring page. But then there's another thing that I did with children during the pandemic, which parents just loved. And there were a lot of kids that really looked forward to doing this every day too. What we suggested, I suggested, is taking a photo of someone they love that they're not able to see because of the pandemic. And then put that picture of that person on a piece of construction paper. And each day they could write around the picture on the construction paper reasons why they are grateful that that person is in their life. And then the next time they were able to see that person again, they would be able to present that to them as something that they created during the pandemic to remind them how grateful they are that that person is in their life. And there are some children who absolutely loved doing that for their grandparents. And then for older students, I found an idea to create an alphabet gratitude, where they take different letters of they take all of the letters of the alphabet and start finding one thing that they're grateful for each letter of the alphabet. And that's a really good project for the older kids. And then I want to share another book with you that I absolutely love. This one's very artistic. It's very vision boardy to me. The woman who created this, you can tell she loves collages. It's this is called Gratitude Soup. And this little girl, she calls herself the Purple Fairy. And she gets a case of the gimme, gimme, want, wants. And she just wants more, 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 more. And her parents tell her that it's not more things that she needs. How did they say it? Let me just find this line. It's not toys that you need. Indeed, there's something better. It's your soul we're going to feed. And we're going to make gratitude soup. So in your heart. So the whole book is about this child discovering the things that she is grateful for. See, it's very much looking like a collage, but in this is all written like a big poem. So in the poem, as she's listing things that she's grateful for, you can see them represented in these pictures throughout the book. So as I go through the poem with the kids, I ask the kids to start thinking about the things that they're grateful for, because then if they would like to create a gratitude collage, they'll have some great ideas by looking at this book. So here's this little purple fairy with her gratitude soup. And what's cute at the back of this book, if you're doing in-person classes, there's actually little soup things that you can copy and cut out for the kids. And they could make a little gratitude collage using the little soup pots. So there's that. I see there's a lot of stuff in the, is anything in the chat for me to be looking at? Because when I'm screen sharing, I can't see chat and you. Okay, you guys go ahead, Victoria.
I just shared a kind of bridging off the gratitude that you're showing. Tinker Garden had a free activity making a gratitude tree.
Oh, beautiful.
So I just shared that with you guys.
Thank you. Oh, I want to write that down. Oh, I've got so many books on my desk. I can't find my pen. Whoops, here it is. All right. Oh, you know what? Let's just add that to that document right here. Okay, a gratitude tree. Okay. All right. That's a great idea. I love that. Well, I'll say this now because I have a really good possibility of forgetting this later. One of the things that what you could even do when you're doing nature modules outside with kids is along the idea of the gratitude tree is a wish tree or a prayer tree. I don't typically call them prayer trees, but I do call them like wish trees or what is something else, an affirmation tree. But there, I have done trees before where, for instance, on a Unitarian Universalist church property, they had a tree and they were fine with the kids using ribbon and using a Sharpie and writing their prayer or affirmation, what I can't remember what it was in that location, on a ribbon. And then we would tie it to the tree and they were totally fine with leaving it there. And then their congregation and the children in their congregation would pick up on that and expand on it. And it became like a permanent fixture on their property. Okay, so let me keep going down here. I think we're done with that. Yes, we are. Okay. Then for the positive affirmations, this is like Spirit Camp opening circle, except I added Louise Hay's book, I Think I Am. And I didn't read this to you guys during Spirit Camp, right? During our curriculum. Oh, this isn't that. This is a short one. So I'll read you this one. I think the next two are short. This is teaching the kids the power of affirmations. And it starts by defining affirmation for the children. Some words that you say, that you think or say and believe to be true. And the child is looking in the mirror. And I love suggesting to children that they do mirror work when they're doing their affirmations. So it starts off with just a little explanation about what this book is about. Did you know that the things you think and say have the power to make a big difference in your life? When you say something over and over, you start to believe it is true. And what you believe creates what you do and what happens to you. These kinds of thoughts and words are called affirmations. Learning to turn your unhappy, negative thoughts into positive affirmations is a great thing to practice. And here's how it works. Say you have a negative thought like, nobody likes me. You can change it to a positive affirmation like, I love myself. I can't read this backwards. And other people love me too. And that changes what happens. Positive things happen, like, hi, want to be friends? The more you can do this, the happier you will be. When waiting around is not what you planned, you may start to have negative thoughts. This line is so long. we will never get into the fair. Picture the fun you will have and say, I make today great. So of all the affirmations books that I've used, I like this one because it shows the negative space that we all get into. And then it is showing the children how to switch that negative into a more positive to create a different effect or a different result. Have you ever wished you looked different or more like someone else? You might feel like saying, I don't like my hair. I wish it were like hers. Instead, look in the mirror every day and repeat, I love myself just the way I am. If your friends all want you to go their way, it's easy to think, if I don't do what they want, they'll be mad at me. Do what is right for you and tell yourself, I stand up for what is important to me. When you don't want to pay attention, you may believe, this isn't about me, so I don't need to listen. Remember that life has a lot to teach you and think, I love to learn new things. When you're feeling all alone, unhappy thoughts might creep in. Why don't they want to talk to me? Help those feelings go away by telling yourself, I am surrounded by love. If it seems easier to sit back and watch than to help, you may think, I wish somebody would help him get up on that pony. Change your thoughts and say, I happily help wherever I can. Even though you may have great things in your life, sometimes you'll still wish, I sure wish I could have that one or one of those. Pay attention to what's good in your life and say every day, I am grateful for what I have. When it comes to taking care of the world you live in, you could think, who cares? One piece of trash doesn't make any difference. Instead, think, I care for my home and the earth. If people around you have nothing good to say, it can bring you down. It's too crowded. I'm hot. Maybe they're right. I'm feeling dizzy. Don't let others' moods change yours. Say, I choose to be positive. You might think you are not creative and that other kids have better ideas than you. I can't decorate my bike. This is going to look awful. Don't give up. Say to yourself, I am filled with creative ideas. When you see kids who looked or act different from you, you might say to yourself, I hope I don't have to ride with them. Try to look past the differences that you see on the outside and think, I see the best in everyone. The end. So tips for doing affirmations. You can make up your own affirmations for anything you want to change in your life. For example, always start an affirmation with positive words such as I can, I am, I do, I have. Say your affirmation over and over whenever you think of it. Say an affirmation especially when you're having a lot of unhappy negative thoughts. Look in the mirror and say your positive affirmations out loud. Write your affirmations down in a notebook or journal. Make a sign with your positive affirmation and hang it where you can see it every day, like on your mirror or a bulletin board. Close your eyes and picture what you want. This is also an affirmation. So at that point, the kids have gotten the hang of the idea of taking a negative way of looking at an experience and shifting it to be a more positive one. So their project for this is to make an affirmation that can support them in something that is challenging for them. And again, just like in the Spirit Camp module, I tell the kids that my affirmation might be, because I feel like I'm a terrible speller. And instead of focusing on I'm a terrible speller, I could create an affirmation that would help me change that negative into a positive and just say I get better with spelling every day, or I do really well on each of my spelling tests. So it becomes something that just helps the children switch that negative to a positive. So the rest of that class, the children are creating their affirmation poster. But in the screen share I have here, I just changed this picture this morning, you guys, and I realized that the top of it is cut off. This, I don't know why this is cut off like this, but maybe I can just make it a little bigger. I don't know. I'll fix that. This is one of the affirmation cards from the affirmation deck that I created. And I wanted to use something that was the property of Dancing Jaguar, as opposed to just a coloring page that I downloaded from a free source on the internet. So anyway, I just changed this like an hour before class, but I will adjust the top of this where it says I love myself, because it looks like it's cut off a little bit. So the kids, if the kids are really little and they like are really struggling because they don't have a parent with them, they're struggling with the idea of coming up with an affirmation, they could just color this page. All right, going into my inner being. This is a cute book. How many of you guys are familiar with the Law of Attraction? Are you guys all familiar with Abraham Hicks? Okay. So this woman contacted me a couple of years ago and said that she had, I'm going to stop screen sharing for just a moment, said that she had written a book and found Spirit Camp online. She did a Google search, found Spirit Camp. Hi, Sarah. And she wanted to know if she could send me a copy of her book. And at the time, I didn't have any Abraham Hicks connection or Law of Attraction connection. I just read the book and I thought, well, this is really interesting. I think I'll just see if I can have a Zoom call with her and find out a little bit more about what's behind the book. And when we had our conversation, she told me that she follows Abraham Hicks and the Law of Attraction. And this book was written because every time she hears Abraham Hicks talk about my inner being, what she keeps hearing is my inner being. So she wrote a book called My Inner Being. It's adorable. So I have done this as a standalone workshop, even in children's bookstores. And it's really cute. Oh, shoot, I forgot to bring up the prop that I use. Oh, it's in my basement. Hang on, I gotta make myself a note to bring this up during lunch. Hang on. All right, so it's another short book. I'm gonna read this to you. So My Inner Being. So those of you who know Abraham Hicks, just kind of enjoy how much my inner being in here is actually Abraham Hicks saying my inner being. My mom says everyone has an inner being, even grandma and grandpa. She actually says being, but I'm pretty sure she means being. My mom likes to meditate to be closer to her inner being. Inner means inside. I don't know how you can get any closer. My mom says when she's happy, she's very close to her inner being. That's easy. I'm usually happy. I must be close to mine a lot. She also told me these things. My inner being loves me all the time. My inner being loves everyone. Even the grumpy ones. My inner being wants me to feel good. My inner being is good at giving directions and hints. Okay, so I got to tell you, when I do this page live in a workshop with kids, I always bring my black sunglasses. And because I have very curly hair, I talk about the resemblance between my inner being and me. My inner being uses my feelings to talk to me, like, this feels good, choose it. Or, this feels bad, don't choose this. And I love how this is also like right up Spirit Camp alley with helping kids connect to their inner wisdom and knowing that sensation in their solar plexus. Okay, I can trust my inner being. My inner being is very wise. My inner being will only look at what I want, never at what I don't want. My inner being is interested in everything that I do, even when I'm having a snack. My inner being is glad that I can feel sad, mad, or happy. However, my inner being is always happy. The end. So I created for virtual stuff this little picture by copying the little bean on the cover of the book here and putting two up on a page. So when I do this as a virtual class, I email this to the parents ahead of time and have the kids download this, just like any of the other coloring pages we've seen. And then I have the kids draw a picture of what they think their inner being looks like. And then this module does go kind of fast. 45 minutes is a stretch for this module. So with the second one, I'll either have the children draw the inner being of their pet, their mom, dad, sibling, whoever else they would like to draw a picture of the inner being. And most of the time the kids choose their dog or their cat and they draw a picture of what their pet's inner being is. But there's also on a website for this book, a PDF that I've given you a link for. I'll show you the link in a second. And what I usually do is read this to the kids and have them talk to me like while they're coloring their inner being. So it talks about setting intentions. So setting intentions plus writing about and doing good feeling stuff is a great habit to start your day with. Excuse me for a second. So the first question is, today I want to feel, and then fill in the blank. So as the kids are coloring, I'll just ask them one by one. So what do you want to feel today? And just go around and listen to all of the kids. And then the next fill in the blank is, I'm going to do these things today to help me feel that way. Go around the room. And then my favorite outside activity is going around the room. Give someone a hug. Hold on for 10 seconds, heart to heart, 20 seconds if you can. And then my favorite thing to do by myself is, and fill in the blank. When I think about blank, I feel happy. And the kids usually put in like their pet or their mom or their dad there, but that's a fill in the blank. And then another fill in the blank, I love going to blank's house. And this was great during the pandemic because then the kids would mention a friend's house that they haven't been able to go have a play date with because of lockdown. And they would say, I'd love going to their house. And I like going there because, so they would like just take it and talk a little bit more about it. So just giving them an outlet to talk about things that they couldn't be experiencing at the time because of what we were dealing with. I like to blank when I'm at my friend's house. And then smile, big smile. Smiling releases good feeling hormones through our bodies, which help keep us healthy. So smile often. And then next fill in the blank is, if I could have any animal as my friend, it would be a blank. My favorite snack is blank. My best season is blank. The toy I like to play with the most is blank. Do your favorite dance move now. And so I just would get the kids up and moving around and showing us their favorite dance move. And when I feel sad or mad, I like to blank, and then I feel better. The best ice cream flavor is, and blank. So as the kids are doing their inner being pictures, which are really short, they go by really fast. I'll be asking them these questions, and let me go on to the SEL thing. So here is, I've got links everywhere for you guys. So when you're teaching, how come my link isn't opening? Oh, there we go. Whoops. Why is this not clicking? Maybe you'll have to copy and paste.
I did have to copy and paste. I can't open it either.
Okay, so let me see. Hang on one second. I'm going to fix it while I'm right here. Copy. And then put the link. There we go. Now it's there. Okay. All right. So there's your coloring page. Right, moving on. Oh, and I got to tell you what I did during the pandemic. When I teach this class for real, I use a car wash sponge. I don't know if you guys are used to seeing them. They look like a figure eight. They're like these really big, thick sponges. And I used car wash sponges. And then I got these acrylic paints. They look like markers, but they're acrylic paint. And I gave the kids each a car wash sponge, and they used the acrylic paints to make like what their inner being looks like. And it was on a sponge, and they could take it home with them. It was so much more fun than this little 2D piece of paper that the kids got virtually. And so during the pandemic, when I tried this in one of my classes, I told kids to come with a kitchen sponge, because like almost everybody has like a small kitchen sponge, you know, that they may have in their homes. But it wasn't as easy to work with as that car wash sponges, because the kitchen sponges tend to be really, really porous. So anyway, that's when I switched. I tried doing the kitchen sponge first, maybe, and I switched to the picture for virtual. But I'm going to make myself a note to go get one of those car wash sponges, because they're cute. All right, so let's move on to the next one. Mindfulness. All right, so this is like out of the nature, Mindfulness and Nature Journal from Spirit Camp. So I think I just had them bring pieces of paper that they could fold in half. We didn't do the Nature Journal cover, the paper bag, none of that, because in the middle of the pandemic, nobody was shopping. So I just used whatever people had in their homes. So I introduced mindfulness by reading this beautiful little book about Mindful Monkey and Happy Panda. I don't know if any of you have ever come across this book, but it's really sweet. It's also very, very short, but it, there's like one sentence on each page, but this, have you ever heard of monkey mind? You know, when people's minds are just going like 100 miles per hour, they can't, like they're in a loop and they're just trying to think of 1,000 things at once. I'm a huge multitasker, so I have monkey mind a lot. So this monkey has monkey mind, and this panda is very mindful with how he lives his life. So the monkey learns about mindfulness from the panda and starts learning how to become present in the moment. And so it's a great way to introduce mindfulness to kids who have like little or no exposure to it at all. And then let me go back to here. So I instructed the kids to fold paper in half and then use it like a book. So then I could bring out my tingshas right behind me. And then, you know, invite the tingshas to ring, ask the children to raise their hand when they can't hear it anymore. And then that kind of sets the tone for the mindfulness exercise we're going to do, where use in the room that they're in, they're going to practice hearing, taste, hearing, smelling. And we could do touching really easily because they're inside their home. So I would, when it came to touching, I would have children touch like fabric on the couch, the texture of the couch or the texture of the curtains or the texture of a plant. So we used touch as opposed to one of the other senses. I can't remember which one, but I mean, there's only five senses. Use whichever one seems like it makes most sense for the group of kids that you're working with. And that entire 45 minutes was spent just mindfully. I think I did one more thing with the kids in here that's not in this. Hang on, I'm gonna add something here. I know where this is on my computer, but I'll do it later. Link be the pond. So there's a meditation that's very famous around the world in mindfulness circles. It's called Be the Pond. And a preschool teacher in California created it. And I use it in all of my workshops when I go into schools. And I think in one of my virtual classes, I was like running out of things to use up in that 45-minute class. So I did the Be the Pond meditation, which takes 3 minutes, but there's a coloring page with it that can make it longer. So hang on for 1 second because here it is. All right, I'm opening it now and then I'll link to it afterwards. Here we go. Okay, so in this mindfulness meditation, it's short and sweet. So I've done this with kids as young as 4. What you do is you have the kids imagine that they are a pond, just a pond. They are the water in the pond. And in that pond are lots of fish. And all their job is to be the pond and observe the fish that are in their pond. And they'll notice that some of the fish are happy, some fish are sad, some fish look lonely, some fish look tired. And just give them a few minutes to, not minutes, seconds to notice and observe the fish in their pond. And then you bring them back out of it. I'm telling you, this is like a 1 or 2 minute meditation. You bring them out of it and have them talk about the fish they see in the pond. And then you connect this. This is the teaching piece, that when they are the pond, they realize that they are separate from the fish. And the fish are swimming by, showing whatever emotion it is that they're experiencing, but they keep swimming by. The pond and the fish are not the same thing. They are two separate entities. So this is like, especially for four-year-olds, the first time they're starting to understand the concept that they are not their emotions. They will experience their emotions like the fish in the pond, where their emotions might swim into their view and then they experience it and then the emotion moves on out. So I usually carry this coloring page in just in black and white. And when I'm teaching mindfulness in the schools, I'll do this meditation because this is really setting up the kids for understanding the separateness between them and their emotions, just like the inner critic and inner champion module helps them separate who they are from the thoughts they're thinking. So these two things go together beautifully. So I'll make sure that I link that. Hopefully I'm gonna remember during lunch because I'll put it on my post-it here, okay? I have to go back to the other screen share. Here it is. Okay. So then I've got some books that are really big on teachings. This one is called Listening with My Heart. And you guys should know Gabby Garcia. She has a great website with teaching downloads for teachers. She's a great resource. I used three of her books during the pandemic. So Listening with My Heart is a story of kindness and compassion. So this little girl, oh good Lord, what's her name? I can't remember. I'll use her name, Esperanza. All right, this little girl, Esperanza, is a really good friend to a new student in school who doesn't speak English very well. And he is just really shy because he can't communicate. He's Vietnamese. So throughout the course of the book, she develops a friendship with this little boy. And then throughout the book, she is also rehearsing for a school play. And in the school play, she makes a really big mistake and she falls down on stage and becomes so embarrassed and humiliated, she ends up hiding and just sobbing and feeling terrible about herself. She's ruined the whole thing. She's ruined it for everybody. And then she gets reminded that she is a beautiful friend to other people and she needs to learn how to become a better friend to herself. This is a great book for kids who are perfectionists. So after I read this book, like on Gabby's website, this is the whole discussion and activity guide for kids. So I can't send this like as a PDF download to parents because it's not my work, it's Gabby's work, but I will use this as notes to talk to kids about how to be a better friend to themselves. And what kind of things would they say to a friend if their friend fell on stage during the school play? What would they say to that friend? And then we take it to like, what kind of things would you like to remember to say to yourself the next time you make a mistake? And then if the kids are old enough, I have them write those things down so they can kind of be setting the stage for the next time they make a mistake. They've got a tool that they've learned and written down to help them remember how to be kinder to themselves with their self-talk when they make a mistake. Let's see, there's all kinds of discussion questions to have. Drawing a picture of yourself doing something that shows care and understanding for yourself. Kind words you would want to say to yourself the next time you make a mistake. And some examples are, that didn't work out the way I wanted. I'm feeling disappointed. This is hard for me. I'm having a hard time. So things that they can say, I can be a friend to myself. Everybody makes mistakes. I did the best I could. So I encourage the kids to write three sentences down that they can remember the next time they're having a hard time. All right. So that's the first of Gabby's books. Let me go see what the next one is.
Ava, I have a question.
Yeah.
So for those worksheets, if you're having an in-person class, you would hand those out, but just not send them.
No, I wouldn't use somebody else's work as my work, especially if I'm charging money for it. So I've never done this in person just because this is one of my stuff from since the pandemic. So what I would do is I would just have the kids have paper and pencil and I would continue to ask them the questions just like I do on a virtual call.
Okay.
Yep. Okay. So the next, let me make sure this is the next one. Yes, listening to my body. Holy cow, this is loaded for kids because you remember how in spirit camp, we were helping the kids understand like that feeling they get in their solar plexus to help them understand that something's not right and to start paying attention to what's going on around them. Listening with my heart is a book that, I mean, not listening with my heart, listening to my body is one of Gabby's books that teaches children the difference between sensations in their body and emotions in their body. So the difference between sensations and feelings. And that is a big thing for kids to start connecting and understanding because let me see if I can find an example. All right. I have ants in my pants. I can't sit still. That's a sensation. And then we'll go into, I don't know. I don't see a page that there's having butterflies in your stomach. That's a sensation. So there are lots and lots of pages in this book where there's a description that the kids have all heard before or probably have heard before about a sensation they're experiencing in their body. And then it goes into how they feel disappointed or how they feel scared or frustrated or angry. And that they can also feel that in their body. So it's helping them understand the difference between what those two things, the sensations and the feelings, feel like in their body. And then let me look at the worksheets for these. I have the same page copied three times. Sorry. Well, so in this particular worksheet, again, this is not something that I would hand out, but I would talk about it to the kids. All right, so one of the things, sensations, is your heartbeat. When you start exercising and doing things that are strenuous, your heartbeat goes up. That's a sensation that you feel in your body. Your muscles and your belly, you can feel butterflies, a tightness, a hardening, strong muscles, feeling light. Your energy, you can feel ants in your pants, energized, alert, relaxed, shaky. Your temperature can be hot or cold, sweating, burning, icy. You can feel thirsty, comfortable, full, hungry. So this is a description of some of the sensations. And then I asked the children, what sensations are you feeling in your body now? And then I also asked them, what emotions are you feeling in your body now? So we start building that up, a vocabulary of the words that the kids can use to separate sensations from feelings. Okay, any questions around that? All right, we've got another Gabby Garcia book coming up, but it's not until a little bit later. All righty, The Kindness Project. Oops, hang on. There. All right. So this is a story of Henry, and this is a mindful book as well. I don't think this one's very long. We have plenty of time, I think. I'm going to go ahead and read you this book. I'm looking at notes here. Okay. So, good morning, class, said Miss Snowden. Can you take your seats on the rug for the mindfulness practice? Remember, this is the time we set aside each day to slow down and pay attention to our bodies, hearts, and minds. Today, we are going to do a new kind of mindfulness practice called heartfulness, which helps us be kinder to ourselves and to others. So, excuse me, I feel like I skipped a page. Nope. So let's go into our mindful bodies. Close your eyes and take three deep breaths. Now think of someone who makes you happy, someone in your family, someone in this class, or even a pet. Have you thought of someone? I'll say words out loud and you can think them while picturing your family member or friend or pet in your mind. If you want to, you can even put your hand over your heart. Miss Snowden said, "May you be happy." In their minds, everyone thought these words for someone who made them happy. Miss Snowden said, "May you be healthy and strong." Everyone thought those words. Miss Snowden said, "May you be peaceful." Then Miss Snowden said, "Try to notice how it made you feel inside to think those kind thoughts. And any way you feel is just fine. Just notice it." When Miss Snowden rang the little bell to end their mindfulness practice, everyone opened their eyes. "Does anyone want to share who they were thinking about?" Miss Snowden asked. Dorothy said, "I was thinking about my brother, Duane. Sometimes he gets on my nerves, but most of the time he makes me happy." Alice said, "I was thinking about my mom. She made me pancakes for breakfast this morning on a school day." Dhruv said, "I was thinking about my little sister, Sonali. It felt weird at first, but then it made me feel pretty happy. She's pretty cool for a little sister." Henry said, "I was thinking about my Rubik's Cube." Everyone laughed, but Miss Snowden said, "That's fine, Henry. I know that your Rubik's Cube is important to you." Miss Snowden said, Thinking kind thoughts about people we love can make us feel really good and want to do kind things. We can even send kind thoughts to ourselves. Speaking of kindness, can anybody think of something kind they did this week? Edwin raised his hand. "I feed my cat every day. Is that a kind thing?" "Yes," said Miss Snowden. "Taking care of your cat is an act of kindness." Edwin smiled. "You are all doing an act of kindness right now by listening to me mindfully. Really paying attention to another person is an act of kindness," said Miss Snowden. The children looked at each other proudly. "So today we are going to start a kindness project. This week, I want you to think of a kind act to do, and then after you do it, draw a picture of it. Next week, we'll share our pictures and hang them on the bulletin board in the hallway." Everybody was excited about the kindness project. Alice raced home after school. She knew exactly what she wanted to do. When it was time for dinner, she told her dad that she was going to set the table. She put out a fancy blue tablecloth and green napkins that she folded carefully. On Saturday, Doris gave her brother Duane a balloon with a peace sign on it. Rosie carried her neighbor Glenn's newspaper right up to his door. Yoab and his friend Jonah cleaned up trash in the park near their school. Andrew stayed after school and sharpened all of Miss Snowden's pencils. Next week in class, everyone shared their kindness project pictures. Everyone, that is, except Henry. "Henry," said Miss Snowden, "where's your kindness picture?" "I don't have one," he said sadly. "I didn't do anything. I guess I'm not kind." "Of course you're kind, Henry," said Miss Snowden, looking concerned. "No, I'm not," said Henry. "I couldn't think of a single thing." "Kindness is stupid." Henry thought about all the other kids sharing their acts of kindness, and he felt awful. Miss Snowden said, "Henry, I'm sure you can think of something kind you did." "No, I can't," yelled Henry. "Kindness is stupid," and he headed toward the classroom door. The class was silent for a moment. Then Rosie raised her hand, and Miss Snowden said, "Yes, Rosie?" "Henry," said Rosie, Don't you remember when we were in the library and you reached a book on the high shelf for me? That was kind. Henry just stopped just before he reached the door. Doris raised her hand too. And remember when I didn't have a snack and you gave me your cookie? That was kind. Henry turned and began to smile just a little bit. And remember when you showed me how to make an origami swan, said Edwin. Remember when you invited me to play basketball when I was new, said Alice. Henry looked a bit surprised. He said, I let my sister play with my Rubik's Cube. Was that kind? Yes, Henry, sharing is kind, said Miss Snowden. It sounds like you've done many acts of kindness. How did you feel when you did those things? Good, I guess, said Henry. It's funny that doing things for other people makes me feel good. That's the great thing about kindness, said Miss Snowden. When you are kind to others, you make them happy and you make yourself happy too. Alice said, just like when we did heartfulness. That's right, Alice, said Miss Snowden. Doris said, I want to do some more kind things. Can we keep doing this project? Of course we can, said Miss Snowden. Let's go out and fill the world with kindness. Later at recess, Henry was flying paper airplanes with Dhruv. Dhruv's airplane flew fast and straight, but Henry's airplane kept flying back to him. Henry laughed and said, I think I'll call this airplane kindness, because when I send it out, it always comes back to me. That's cool, said Dhruv. Can you teach me how to make my plane do that? Sure, said Henry. I'd be happy to. So in this module, I'm going to go back to the little screen share here. I had the kids make up kind acts of kindness they could do. Now remember, we were in a pandemic. Nobody could go anywhere. So I have to delete that. So we had to think of stuff they could do at home. Make a coupon book for an elderly person and give it to them later. Help with a household chore at home. Tell someone you know that you're proud of them. So we did a whole list of things here. But then during the pandemic call, somehow I came up with this other list. Like, it's a little bit longer, but it's mostly the stuff that you're seeing there. But some kids mentioned carrying groceries in from the car, helping to put groceries away, water the plants in the house, unload the dishwasher, fold the towels, help pick up garbage in the neighborhood. So those are a few other things that kids came up with. And then I asked them to draw a picture here of something that they did that was kind that day. And then if they could write, they're old enough to write how they showed kindness. And then we did, hang on, I've got a note here. Look at the purple tab in the book. So okay, so then we went and did the heartfulness exercise that Ms. Snowden did with her classroom, where she had them picture somebody they love. And then I had them place their hands over their heart, close their eyes, and repeat after me, may you be healthy and strong. May you be happy. May you be healthy and strong. And may you be peaceful. And then I had the kids check in with me about how they felt inside when they were saying those things or thinking those thoughts towards somebody that they loved. And then I asked them who they were thinking of when they did that exercise. Okay, I think that's it for that one. Hang on. Yes. And then homework for that class was to do something kind for someone and then have the kids share about it at the beginning of our next class. So they had a kindness project for homework. Okay, we're winding down here. Finding the quiet place within. All right, this is one I also do in public schools. So it's another little kind of mindfulness exercise, I guess. I use the book called Charlotte and the Quiet Place. Now, Charlotte is a little girl who is really sensitive to noise. So sometimes if I'm in a in-person classroom, I'll ask if, actually I could even do this online, ask if there's anybody here who is really sensitive to a lot of loud noises. And then I tell them to pay close attention because we're going to give them a really good tool to help them with that. So the book goes through Charlotte's experience with feeling like every place around her is noisy. Her house is, her school is, her neighborhood is, the library is, every place she goes, even in the park, it's noisy. And she gets to the point where she just can't take it anymore. And then at that point in time, she takes her dog for a walk and her dog takes off the leash chasing a squirrel. And it ends up going into the park. And she finally catches up to her dog and she is exhausted from running and chasing her dog. So she sits down, whoa, my notes fell out. She sits down near a tree to rest. And she feels her breathing. She feels how hard her breathing is. And then she falls asleep. And when she wakes up, she is really feeling how her breathing is really calm. And that she discovers, makes that connection, that there is a quiet place within her that she can go to when the world outside of her is too noisy and hard for her to cope with. So she ends up discovering that even when, whoops, I'm trying to get back to the other places here. Even when her house is noisy, her school is noisy, the neighborhood is noisy, everything around her is noisy, she knows that there's that quiet place within that she can visit anytime she needs to. So what I do with the children after I read that book is I invite them to do a little guided meditation with me where they go to a place that they have experienced that peace and quiet. It could be like some kids say, oh, I was at my grandparents' camp, or like I was in my bedroom lying down in my beanbag chair, just some place where the kids can go where they feel really calm and peaceful. And I just ask them to like connect that sensation that they feel when they're there and how peaceful it feels inside their body, how their breathing is relaxed, how they're, there's nothing there but them and the environment that they're in. And then I just remind them that that place inside of them that they're experiencing right now is a place that they can visit whenever they need to. And then we'll slowly come out of that guided meditation. And I asked the children to draw a picture of where it was that they were in their meditation, and they can share and tell stories about what it feels like for them or where they're at in their quiet place inside. Okay, let's move on. I can do hard things. This is the other Gabby Garcia book. All right. I can do hard things is mindful affirmations for kids. And I feel like this one takes the affirmations module that we did, taking something negative and finding the positive spin on it to help change the energy around that situation. This takes that even a little bit deeper, because this book is about helping kids with like harder things, that why the book's called I Can Do Hard Things, like I can listen to understand different points of view. I can share my gifts with the world. I can try again rather than give up. I can speak up when it would be easier to stay quiet. So I feel like this one takes the affirmation ones we did earlier and takes it to a deeper place. And again, it's a really short book. And this is one that I would definitely do with older kids. I'm not sure like this would be like for preschool through maybe age 6, but I think it's really good for slightly older kids. And then I have, oh, here's the some of the affirmations that I wrote down that I was just reading to you. I had that piece of paper in my hand. All right, nature mandalas. So this one I did during the pandemic on a weekend, like a day right before we went into a weekend. So if I had a Friday afternoon class, this would be the kids' homework that they could do with their families before the next class. So to go outside and create a nature mandala with stuff they're finding out in their, on their property or when they go for a walk, and then take a picture of it and then either send it to me or just show it on their parent's phone in the next class. I had kids literally just holding up their phone and going, okay, here's the mandala that I made during class. But it got kids outside and it got them being creative and artistic with nature materials. And this could also be a nature module that you do if you're going to be doing a series of after school classes. This would be a perfect one to do where kids could even work together in teams like they do with the Fairy House module in Spirit Camp. They could work together in teams and create nature mandalas and spend some time doing a little walk around the property, gathering the materials. If they're like Spirit Camp kids, or you've done nature work before where they've made a pouch, you could have them take their pouch with them and do the bird seed. So anyway, that's a good one. And parents were just really looking for ways, excuses to get their kids like outside doing something so they could be getting some fresh air and exercise. So that was a good one that I did. Oh, hang on. I see I've got a note there about a book I read. Hang on. Where is it? I don't see it. That's weird. All of my books are right there. I'm just not getting my hands on it. So anyway, there's a book called The Tree by Dana Lyons, and it's a beautiful book. And I had a couple of moms on the call actually cry when I read it. So if you ever have an opportunity to get The Tree by Dana Lyons, it's a beautiful book and you could use it in any nature program that you're doing with kids. All right, I want to share this other book with you because you could do a whole series of classes, short classes, on just this one book here, Find Your Happy. So I'm going to stop share for a second. This book is not a book to read to kids, but it's a book full of exercises that you can do with kids to help them, a kid's self-love book. So I'll share with you some of the stuff that I've done with kids in here. So ask anyone, what is happy? Ask anyone that question and you will receive many different answers. What's happy for one person may not be the same for another. The important thing is to define what happy is for you. So we all know one thing about happy. When you feel it, you feel really, really good and joyful, and our hearts are blissful. Our bodies are content and we smile and we laugh. When you're happy, it not only affects you, but showers its splendid radiance upon those who are around you. So let's take a journey through this book and see what you can do to be the happiest, joyful person you can be. So thinking happy thoughts, there's a whole bunch of affirmations on here. And I might just have the kids repeat after me some of the affirmations on this page. And because we've done a whole bunch of affirmation work, I don't really dwell on that one, but I do take some time to have them repeat affirmations. And then speak words that make you smile. And then I love this for kids. It's we as adults, I'm sure, have heard this many, many times, but for most children, this is the first time they hear it. Be mindful of your thoughts, for your thoughts become words. Be mindful of your words, because your words become your actions. Be mindful of your actions, for your actions show who you are. Be mindful of who you are, for this is how you create your future. So that I spend some time on that. And if the kid, I ask if the kids are older, I'll even ask them to write it down, because that's really an important four sentences to remember. And then let's see, what's this next one? Suggesting that there be table talk at dinner time, with asking questions to everyone in your family. What is the best part of your day? What is the thing you love most about yourself today? And what's one thing you would change about your day if you had the power to do so? So it's a way to get the conversation going with other members in your family. And you are also sharing what you love most about yourself each day, and having the opportunity to learn from the people that are at the dinner table with you what they most love about themselves that day. Then it has a little section on yoga, but for virtual spirit, for the virtual classes, I just skipped this page because it was really challenging, because some kids didn't have room to be able to do it, or they were sitting in front of a computer monitor, and if they went to go do the yoga thing, I couldn't see them anymore on screen, so we just skipped that one. But we did mirror play, and I had the kids look at their picture on the Zoom screen and say the affirmation to themselves right on the Zoom screen. And it's sort of like doing mirror work. So there's a page on mirror work. We talked about the kids making an effort, their happy journal, which is basically like a vision board, cutting out pictures from a magazine or a book on what types of careers interest you. What colors are your eyes drawn to the most? Cut out activities that look like they may be fun and exciting for you to enjoy. Cut out places you would like to go. And then ask the kids to create a little happy journal for themselves between then and the next call. And then also talking about vision boards. One of these is the happy journal. This side is a vision board. There's a beautiful little meditation here that I did with the kids, seashell meditation. Finding happiness in nature, just all kinds of lists, all kinds of ways that you can connect with nature to be able to really feel grounded and happy. Attitude of gratitude. This is one that we could easily do virtually. So we spent some time on this. And for the parents on the call, like, this is things that they could do to express gratitude. This one over here is the benefits of being grateful and how your body reacts and responds to it and how it makes you feel.
Ava, is that all the pages out of read, the Find Your Happy Place?
These are all out of Find Your Happy. Yep.
Okay. I missed that part. Thank you.
Yep. This is a great, great little book for all kinds of classes. And I mean, it's a great book to find like jumping off points. Start with one of these exercises and you could build on that, and you could create like a half a dozen different after school modules just out of this book. This is using your body to create your own dance to make yourself feel happy. here's a whole page on keeping your chakras happy. And I didn't have kids who knew what their chakras were, because I didn't know from one day to the next who was coming to these calls in the pandemic. So I ended up skipping this one, but I used pieces of this during one of my virtual calls much later when I was doing an actual program with kids, like a paid program. I was able to use some of the ideas from that particular page. I'm trying to see what else I did. The calming jars, doing like the meditation jars from Spirit Camp. That's a whole piece on that. 16 seconds to happiness. Okay, this is the Abraham Hicks thing. You think a thought for 17 seconds and then you've shifted your thought process for the day. Or if you know that Abraham Hicks teaching, I don't know if you guys are aware of it, but if you think something for 17 seconds, it really becomes something that you can build on. So if you wake up and all of a sudden your first thought is something negative, switch it to something positive and hold that for 17 seconds, and it sets the tone for your day. Well, they're teaching that to kids. 16 seconds to happiness. I've never heard the 16 second part, but I have heard 17 seconds. This is just cute little pages to end the book with, but this is a really cool book. So I used this for all kinds of things when kids just needed pick-me-ups during the pandemic. All right, let's go back. And I think we're almost done with this. I had them do a little worksheet. So I had them finish these sentences for me. I am happy because I fill in the blank. I love myself because I have great ideas, and one of them is I am perfect the way I am, and my best quality is I can do anything I put my mind to, and today I will. And then they told me those in the call, and then their homework was to do those in front of a mirror before the next call. But for those particular beginning of pandemic calls, I almost never knew from one day to the next who I was going to have in the calls. So homework kind of never went checked because there'd be a whole different group of kids the next day. Talking sticks. This was a really important tool because families needed to find healthy ways to communicate with each other because everyone was piled in on top of each other 24/7 with no breaks. So parents loved this module to be able to help them establish healthy communication during conflict in the home. And then I did the breathing techniques for self-regulation. I did those just like I do in virtual spirit camp, which we'll be covering later today. Again, that was a helpful thing because so many kids were dealing with such high levels of anxiety at the beginning of the pandemic. So this was really, really helpful in providing them with some tools. And then I read Moody Cow Meditates and did this module right out of Spirit Camp. And I showed everyone how to make a meditation jar. And I did not have the expectation that they were going to come to the call with any materials whatsoever. Because like I said, I never knew who was coming to the calls. So it was just like show and tell. So if parents, if you have a jar like this at home, and if you happen to have some glitter and some clear glue, and if you don't have glitter and clear glue, maybe you could try using glitter glue if you have that, because that does work too. It's just a really expensive way for me to make them in bulk. It just became a show and tell, me showing parents how to make it with their child. And that is it. Let me see if I have any other notes here. And then you guys, if you have questions, go ahead and ask.
Ava, what's the UUA website?
UUA web, Universalist Unitarian Association.
Thank you.
Yep. Any other questions? I'm going to change this view so I can see you all better now.
I have a question. When have you done after school classes in person?
Not I did in school classes in the Montessori school before the pandemic. I haven't done any in school or after school teaching since the pandemic.
Okay.
Yeah. Any other questions? No? Okay. All right. So why don't we take a break, and I'll meet you back here in an hour, and we will do virtual spirit camp. All right. Okay, everybody. Thank you. Have a good lunch.